This is Community Care, the show that focuses on treatment, services, and the local impact of opioid addiction, a disease that nobody is immune to. Here's your host, Jeff Pruett.
Hi, welcome to Community Care. My name is Jeff Pruett, and this is our second show that we're going to talk about the opioid crisis and what are we doing with it in our community to work with our individuals who are happen to be in addiction. Today, we're talking with Matt Sandifer. Matt's with Triad Behavioral Resources. It's located in Reidsville, and also New Vision Therapy. Both companies work together so that we can give the best service we possibly can to our citizens in Rockingham County and the surrounding area. So, good morning, Matt.
Good morning, Jeff.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm excited about this opportunity to talk with you and about Community Care.
Well, this is a good opportunity for me. We haven't talked for a while. Matt and I have known each other for, I don't know, 5-6 years, yep, somewhere along the line. Worked with each other in several counties on several different projects along the same avenue, if you would, of working with the opioid crisis in several areas. Great resource for Rockingham County, Guilford County. What other areas are you in?
We're also in Wilmington.
Wilmington.
So Triad Behavioral Resources is in Wilmington, Rockingham County, and Greensboro, and the New Vision Therapy, which is located in the same spot, mm-hmm, is also in Greensboro and Reidsville.
And we appreciate you coming to Reidsville a few years back.
It's going to be about 2.5, coming up on 3 years.
Wow, time does get away.
It does.
And you were one of the, if not the first.
We were.
To come into the area because I was desperately looking for someone to please come into Rockingham County. We have business. We have an issue. We need help. And you graciously came into the area, set up shop in Reidsville. Where's your shop at in Reidsville?
232 Gilmer Street.
And that's right behind the Chamber of Commerce.
Yep.
It's on the second floor.
It is.
Yeah, and great setup. Easy to get to, easy access, and we're very glad that you came in to Rockingham County. So, with that, take a few minutes, and all the time you like, actually,
okay,
and tell us if, for our folks who have an issue of addiction, family members who are trying to help them get into treatment,
yep,
and need to get into the door, how would they come and visit you guys?
So, I'll start with the phone number. It's always the easiest way, mm-hmm, to start. Call 336-389-1413. We also have two websites. That would be triadbehavioralresources.com and newvisiontherapy.org. Either website or calling us directly, you'll speak to admissions. And our rule of thumb is that we want to get someone in after initial contact within 36 to 48 hours. Most of the time, it's that the very next day. The rubs are holidays and weekends. That kind of makes it difficult. We're an office-based clinic, so we're available Monday through Friday. And what will happen is you'll come in and you'll see a clinician, a therapist, and they will sit down with you, find out about what your struggles are, what your goals are, what you're looking to accomplish, what kind of support you need. And then we'll gather that information, and we'll give that information to one of our doctors. And sometimes people need what is called medicated-assisted therapy, where medications are used to help the brain stabilize, while in therapy, where we're working by talking and through individual and group, how to help folks develop coping skills. So it's a two-pronged approach. You'll meet with a therapist to help sort out what your goals are, and you're instructing us on what you want to accomplish. Then we get you an appointment with the doctor. The doctor prescribes medication if appropriate, and then we work with the doctor through this process, group therapy and individual therapy, to support you.
And you talked about medication-assisted,
mm-hmm,
treatment. Tell us a little bit about medications. What kind of medications are we using?
So for opiate dependency, the primary drug that is used, that we use, is buprenorphine. And there are several different brands. There is Suboxone, which a lot of people are familiar with. Mm-hmm. There's also Zubsolv. Mm-hmm. There's also Sublocade, which is a long-term implant so that you don't have to take the medication several times a day. And different scenarios, different brands work best for lifestyle or person's biochemistry. So that's the primary drug used. Then there are other drugs like naloxone, which is a blocker. For some folks have gotten to a place where they just want to, instead of having a medication that replaces the opiate, they want a medication that prevents feeling the high of taking an opiate. Mm-hmm. But if it's not opiate dependency, it may be alcohol. And there are medications that help reduce cravings. Many people have heard about an old drug, Anabuse. It's still used, but it's not used widely. Mm-hmm. And what Anabuse does is if you drink while taking it, you become really violently sick, so it discourages you from drinking. But there are other more refined drugs that reduce cravings. Campril is one. Naloxone, again, for some people, will actually reduce the effects of alcohol. Then our doctors can also, if you have depression or anxiety, can prescribe medications that are safe for you to take. They're not addictive. A lot of folks will take a class of drugs called benzodiazepines. That's Klonopin, Valium, and Xanax. And those drugs are pretty addictive. They're very addictive, actually. Mm-hmm. And so the doctors can look at other mood stabilizers or antidepressants that can help with those struggles, whether it's depression or anxiety, in addition to talk therapy, which is actually the research shows is the most effective way to help folks learn coping skills for anxiety and depression.
So you come in the door, see a therapist, mm-hmm. see a doctor,
yep.
get into counseling.
Mm-hmm.
If medication-assisted treatment's for you, you start that, and then you get on to a what's, I guess, best practice mm-hmm. that works for those. And it's up to the person to stay in the program from that point forward. Is there a time frame that you try to work with someone to maybe wean them down on these medications if they're taking that? Or is that also something that is, it depends on the individual?
It's highly individualized.
Mm-hmm.
So a rule of thumb that we suggest specifically for folks that have opiate dependency mm-hmm. is, because folks come in, it's pretty scary. There's a lot of stigma around opiate dependency. There's fear and embarrassment about asking for help. And so we try to make things as concrete as possible. And what we tell folks is we're looking at an 18 to 24 month period. Some people are able to accomplish the getting stabilized and tapering down and fully being detoxed more quickly. Some folks it will take longer. That depends on all kinds of variables. It depends on life circumstance, the extent of their chemical use, the age at which they started. When you start younger, it's harder in adulthood to begin to get off those medications and those drugs. The strength of the drugs that you're taking also will affect how long it takes to get you fully detoxed. So we have to look at those variables. And if during this period of stabilization, if someone has a weekend where they stumble and they have a return to use, that may stretch things out a little more, what we will do with a return to use. We don't see it as a failure. We see it as, with any chronic illness, symptoms reemerged, and what we need to do is learn from that and go back and correct some things, maybe increase some things. Often what I say is if your diabetes is resistant to management through diet and exercise, we need to add pharmaceuticals like some form of insulin
mm-hmm.
and then get the right level of insulin to be able to get the diabetes under control. And so that's the same approach we take with substance use disorder, with opiate use disorder. Because of what opiates do to the brain, and particularly the mu receptor, it is very difficult for the brain to get stabilized again. It's not impossible. It's very possible. It's just difficult. And that's one of the things we tell patients. Difficult does not mean impossible. It just means that we have to be individualized. We have to be supportive. We have to be intensive in the beginning. And once things have stabilized, the intensity, the frequency of visits to the clinic will diminish, and slowly after full detox will fade away. So we say 18 to 24 months, but we also give the caveat of it's really based on your progress and what you need.
And one of the things you said is going leading right into the next statement, I guess, is that if someone uses while they're in the program, is they're not getting kicked out of the program.
Nope.
That's not what you're...
We don't do that.
It's not looked at as a failure. It's looked at as that we need to go back.
Go back to the drawing board.
And start again.
That's right.
And start working with it. Because there's not a one fix for everyone on this. And that's what you have to learn. I appreciate the fact that I hear you say you want the person to tell you what really their goal is.
That's right.
And work from there. Because I've had folks in the community that come up to me, you know, and those who know me come up to me in a restaurant or Walmart or wherever the heck I'm at, and that's okay. Continue doing that, please. And you know, the question of, well, I'm scared to go in. I'm scared to get started. I don't want people seeing me. So we're looking at the stigma.
Yes.
And there's a couple of different ways I'm looking at stigma as a layman. Mm-hmm. And that is, you know, the personal stigma of the individual trying to get in, that maybe wants to get into a program, yeah. But as you said, you know, that how's people going to look at me? You know, right. People going to see me coming in this building. They know what to do. And then there's the community stigma of people who just need to be better educated right. on what's going on, need to get rid of the stigma of, you know, you can't fix this, and there's nothing you can do to help these folks. Look, that's why organizations like this have come into the county, and we've been fortunate enough to get more than one
right.
Into the county because there are different philosophies behind it. And it's fine what works. Now, I know this program is a very good program. Again, like I say, we've known each other 5 or 6 years probably right. And worked in different areas. And I'm glad that he came into Rockingham County, glad he's here. And you've taught me something today. And that is, you know, naloxone.
I'm happy.
Hey, you can go home, right?
That's right.
That naloxone helps with alcohol.
It does, and not everyone with alcohol. Typically,
right.
So here's what's interesting, and I learned this when I started doing this work. The folks that naloxone helps with alcohol are also the folks that have become dependent on opiates. Some people take opiates and don't like them mm-hmm. because of their brain chemistry, but they might like alcohol. But the folks that opiates trips their trigger, mm-hmm. that it works in their brain, and also alcohol works in their brain, that when you give them naloxone, it blocks the receptor site for what some call mu alcoholics, because the mu receptor site is where the opiates act. And so for that group of folks that have a problematic relationship with alcohol, it's a very useful intervention. And you find that out by interviewing the patient, getting to know the patient, and seeing, you know, what their use history is like. Otherwise, and that's one of the reasons we so much believe in individualizing this. You know, and one of the other things, Jeff, that you mentioned that I think is really important is we do have other providers coming into the county with different philosophies, and I think that's really great. And here's why. I think because one size doesn't fit all, mm-hmm. and we do not say that our way is the right way. What we say is, let's see what you're trying to accomplish, and here's what we do, and if it doesn't work, we now have other resources that we can partner with.
Right.
And I think it's important for us to and for the community to understand this is partnership. This is working together, trying to support the community.
And to add on where I was going a few minutes ago was, I've had people tell me that my initial concern and what I want to work with is the fact that I don't have a place to live right now.
Right.
You know, I know that they have an addiction issue. And for folks out there that think, well, if you fix that, everything else goes together. But you got to start where they are.
Right.
So to hear you say that, I think is great for the community to know. You start where they are and work from there.
Yep.
Because it's not a one thing fits all.
Right.
And for someone to come in and at least admit, you know, this is where I'm at. I think it's great that you're open up to that and you can start with that and then move forward with that. Okay. Education in the community.
Mm-hmm.
That's huge because we talked about the stigma. We have it everywhere. It doesn't
right.
matter if it's a rural, urban area. It doesn't matter. We
That's
have
right.
a stigma in the community. Is there what can we do to continue to work with that? And let's, you know, as I tell folks in the community, we really need to, you know, start with our school-age kids, of course,
mm-hmm.
and maybe even with elementary school kids to just talk about not the dangers of the medications and things like that, but you know, parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles putting up medication. You know, they don't need to be out in the open, things like that, because temptation's there.
Right
now, this is December 11th. We are in a holiday season. I don't want to throw that out there for folks. We have multiple holiday seasons during the year, and we have family in our house. And God knows, we like to say we know all our family and friends very well, but we don't.
Right.
You never know what's going to happen. And our children bring children into the house, and we want our houses open. So we want to make sure that we've got stuff out of sight. Don't want to tempt anyone, because 30 years ago and moving forward, this kind of contributed to get us where we are right now.
That's right.
I hear folks say, well, you know, they kind of beat up our medical staff, and we don't want to do that.
Right.
Because it was best practice.
That's right.
Best practice to use these medications to keep folks, to reduce pain.
They created a fifth vital sign, pain.
Exactly. And everybody in here knows this, that when you went into the doctor, or God forbid you had to go into an emergency room or something like that, you were asked, scale of 1 to 10, 1 being not much, 10 being I can't stand it, tell me what your pain level is. And you know as well as I do, what did people start doing? You know, well, I'm 11.
Yes.
I'm a 12. It hurts real bad. Because what folks learned was, after being on these medications for a long period of time, not knowing that, you know, that there was, you're now dependent.
Well, and unfortunately, doctors and patients were instructed that if you have chronic pain, that you couldn't become physically dependent, which was just not based in science.
Right, right. And I'm glad you said that, because that's the direction I was hoping you would go with it, because you need to hear that from the professionals of how we got where we are and how we're trying to rewire the brain now to get back to as close to where you were once upon a time and what it takes to get there. So we talk about education in the community. We need to work with our schools.
Yes.
We need to work with our communities and our civic organizations. That's one of the things that I'm fortunate enough to do, because I can't do what you do. You know, this seems to be what I'm best at.
I was going to say, so you're out in the community doing this advocacy work and doing the education too.
Right. Well, and trying to get folks like you into the community and then get to understand how important you are.
Right.
That's why we're doing this today.
Well, and one thing I wanted to add, Jeff, about educating our children, sometimes parents will say to me that if you talk about drugs, it's going to encourage them to use drugs.
Well, you hear that from the schools.
That's right.
Yeah.
And the reality is, kids experiment with alcohol and drugs without anybody telling them about it.
Yeah.
And so if you can give them information that helps them make more informed decisions, particularly if there's a family history of substance use disorder. If a child has one parent who has a history of substance use disorder, some studies show that child's risk rate is 7 times greater than the general population of developing a substance use disorder. And so being able to inform children of that, so when they make the decision later in life to use alcohol or use other drugs, that they're making informed decisions. Because also the research shows, the longer you delay the initiation of drug use or alcohol use, ideally to the age of 25, just telling you what's ideal, not I don't know what's realistic, I don't think that is, but the longer you delay that because of brain development, the less of an impact the substance use disorder can have on the person. The current average age of initiation is 14. Now the good news is that has crept up over the last few years. The rate of alcohol use among teenagers is decreased, but the rate of marijuana use among teenagers is increasing. So there's some good news and some bad news, and there's probably cultural issues with that. Mm-hmm. But I think the more education they have, you know, talking about something doesn't plant it in a child's mind. They already have their own minds. Talking about informed information so they can make decisions for their own health makes sense.
And we've seen over the past few years where we, you know, just a few years ago, we were talking about the 21 to 35 group. That's now that's extended both ways.
Yes.
And access to medications, and now the illicits that have become so easily accessible.
And increasingly dangerous with the introduction of fentanyl.
Correct. And this is very powerful, and we see, and that's why we saw 72,000 people die.
Right.
nationwide last year, and about 2,500 in North Carolina. Now, part of the governor's council and what they want to do is reduce the death rate. Mm-hmm. Well, I want to give a plug to our EMS, our law enforcement, ED staff, etc., the use of Narcan, naloxone, to bring people back. People aren't dying.
Right.
They're
dying less.
Less.
Right.
But now we've got to use agencies like yours to be able to get them in there, right, and to increase those, especially in our rural areas, mm-hmm, is to get that opportunity there for folks to have a place to go and to understand that, it's hard work. But with folks like you, the good doctors that you have, and understanding that, you know, it's going to take time, and you're there for them, you're not going to fire them return to use, and that you're going to continue to work with them, and you have to, it takes a little while to figure out where you need to be,
right?
You know, and patience, and it'll get there. Transportation seems to be an issue, especially in our rural areas.
Yes.
And I know you've been working with that also, along with a lot of the rest of us, but, you know, it's important that you get there.
Yep.
And the fact that you're there in Reidsville, it's a great location. Wish I could have you over in the West. Maybe one day we can actually make something like that work out.
That's right.
But having you there in Reidsville is great. Okay. We're running low on time. I do want to talk about getting businesses.
Okay.
That's another thing that we hear a lot of. Businesses saying, you know, we got people that interview great. They either don't take the drug test or can't pass the drug test.
Right.
And so it's really working with the businesses to re-educate and relearn how can you take that person that interviews great and still be able to use them and get them involved in something and get that person in to work. And is that something you can help with?
Sure we can, and we could do that. We can do that on an individual basis. We could do that with businesses going in and providing education to supervisors, managers, HR. We can also partner with actually providing treatment. That the idea that your employee interviews well, has the skills, but is positive on a urine drug screen, that person, so there's no quick down blanket easy answers.
Right.
So it's important not to disregard that person just because of that. The idea of saying, hey, you interviewed well, you got the skills, but you were positive for this substance. If you're willing to go and seek treatment and get that under control, then and a probation period. Let's see what the urine, and monitor with urine drug screens, monitor with therapy and counseling. Can it actually create more loyalty, more devotion and dedication to the work, which will increase the productivity of that individual, as opposed to constantly, as someone who's hiring, limiting my pool of people I can hire. Because eventually you get down to, well, I don't have people with the skills now. And generally speaking, someone who has their substance use disorder managed is very intelligent, very creative, and very productive. Now, the brain disorder will interfere with that if it's not managed, but it's manageable.
Mm-hmm.
And the other piece of that, it can reduce the stigma. Most people have a brother or a sister or a grandparent or an aunt or an uncle or a child that has been touched by substance use disorder. It's something that many people still don't talk about. But if we can let folks know this is a chronic brain disease, it's not a moral failing, that may also help. Because, you know, some people that say, I won't hire someone that's positive for a substance because I don't know if I can trust them. They may steal from me, or they may steal time from me. Maybe not material, but time.
Mm-hmm.
That is not necessarily true. And that's why it's important to have a probation period to monitor folks to see what productivity looks like. Because you are likely to create a very loyal, devoted, productive employee this way.
And most businesses have a probation period already set up.
Right.
So if a business out there wanted to talk to you, they could call.
Absolutely.
And set up something with you.
I can come talk to them. We can meet. I can talk to whoever decision makers are about policies and hiring. I'd be glad to do that.
And that's another great resource from this organization for not only the Greensboro area, but for Rockingham and surrounding counties.
That's correct.
Because it's important to know that just because you're set up in one area, people come from other areas.
Right.
To use your service.
Or work outside of the county they live in. They may live in Rockingham and work outside, or vice versa. And so that doesn't exclude folks.
Okay, excellent. So, again, working with the schools, that's a tough one.
Mm-hmm.
And that's everywhere.
Right.
That's not just in the rural areas, but that's everywhere.
That's right.
You know, I'd like to see more done with the schools. I don't know if we could actually, I mean, we could probably do a whole show on schools.
Probably.
Right. But the important thing is to be a little open, if the schools could be a little more open to the education part of it, maybe building a peer group within the school to work with this, I think it would help. That's the world according to Jeff. I understand that. But it's some things that I've seen that's worked in other areas. It didn't start in North Carolina, y'all.
Right.
This came across the country like a fire, and you know, we've been hit hard. Reducing deaths is important. We, you know, we want to give folks the opportunity to get into treatment and to get their life back, because you know, they're losing families, they're losing homes, they're losing stability. So
And there's a whole generation of children being raised by either one parent or extended relatives because their parents have overdosed and died. And so that's going to leave emotional traumatic scars on folks, which actually increases the risk factor for other substance use. And so it's one of the reasons why I think early, the research is clear, the earlier you intervene, the better the long-term outcomes. And the other thing, so I had two thoughts when you talked about the school, and I'll make them brief. One is there are recovery high schools and or recovery enclaves in some high schools where a peer support group come together, and they have great outcomes, because then it's hard to stay clean and sober in high school if you want to. It's not the going trend.
Right.
And so when you can have a safe place or a safe group you can go to, it's supportive. The other thing is more and more, and I was talking to a local university last week, and they get these well-educated, brilliant children coming in whose emotional skills are not developed. They're anxious, they're depressed, and they're open to substance use disorder and also sexual assault, because folks are more vulnerable when they're under the influence. And so one of the things folks are seeing in university admissions is these brilliant kids coming in with underdeveloped emotional coping skills. And we could start doing something about that in the schools too.
Excellent. And the other thing, recovery courts.
Yes.
Is get recovery, not drug courts.
Right.
Recovery courts.
Right.
I'm happy to say we're starting to see that train of thought leak into our our courts, and I think that's going to come about in the areas, in the surrounding areas.
And I think it's important for folks to understand recovery courts do not excuse behavior that's illegal. You're still accountable. But recovery courts are an attempt to treat the brain disease, because incarceration doesn't treat the brain disease, it treats the behavior. And if you want to actually have lasting effect, the brain disease and the behavior both have to be addressed.
Excellent. A lot talked about today.
This has been great. I'm really honored and appreciate the opportunity to talk with you and to be able to give this message out to folks in the community and know that there's a resource here to support you and your goals.
We could talk about this for half a day.
We sure could.
And on probably many days. But there's a lot of information that's went out to folks. You've got the information on how to get in touch with Matt and his group. And if you have questions, you can call me. Again, my name's Jeff, 336-932-5645. Just give me a call. I'm going to send you in the direction to talk to someone else, to the resources that we have in the community, and there's more than one.
That's right.
And we're going to be doing more of these, and I'm hoping people will watch them, be a little open-minded to what it is. We got to reduce our stigma on both ends and give folks the opportunity to recover. The businesses, I really hope you're watching this and you listen to this, because great resource sitting right here that can come in and help you with that. Because I understand, you don't really know what to do, because we talked about the new employee, but what about the employee that's been working for you for a long time and all of a sudden comes up hot on a drug test?
That's right.
And you really want to work with that person. There's an opportunity to do that. Again, my name is Jeff Pruett. Matt, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff.
And we will talk at another time. I hope everybody sees this and gets something out of it. Thank you very much.